And good morning, Cherry Road.
Good morning.
All right. And these are our announcements for today. On Tuesday, we will have our men's prayer meeting, which will be at 11 o'clock a.m. And then at 12:15 p.m. on Tuesday, we will have our brown bag Bible study. On Wednesday, we will have our choir rehearsal, which will be at 2 o'clock p.m. Following that, later on in the evening, we will have our Bible study at 5:30 p.m. All right, on tonight, Sunday, we will have our prayer time, which will be at 5:30 p.m. Other announcements, it is time to sign up on the flower calendar for next year.
Wait a minute, I have it here.
All right.
And a pen.
Thank you so much for the day. This morning we have the calendar on the table, which will be on the table in the back if you would like to sign up, or you may call the church office to reserve a date. The cost for flowers for a week is only $50. All right, we will be observing the Lord's Supper and just a little later in the service this morning. Now, please turn your attention to the screen to watch our Lottie Moon video.
When someone takes an AK-47 and put it to your chest and cock it, you know that you're only one pull of a trigger away.
Some people would say that my parents weren't very responsible parents for taking me to Kuwait, where the Persian Gulf War broke out. Some people would say that's irresponsible, to take your kids with you into your calling where there's so much suffering. But rather than it taking me further from God, it actually helped take me closer to God. Because one of the things I learned at an early age, God actually calls the people of God to move towards the hardest places of this earth. Nobody knew anything about Kuwait. It was just this little dot on this map in the Middle East. But 3 months later, on August 2nd, 1990, Saddam Hussein and Iraqi troops invaded Kuwait, and we were living right downtown. There were four sets of Iraqi troops that broke into our apartment. And as a 10-year-old, I just began crying. And I didn't actually know if I was gonna live. I didn't know if we were actually gonna even make it through that day.
We knew we had to leave quickly. I was held downstairs by gunpoint, but when I came back up the steps and we all jumped in a car and drove out downtown, and there were Iraqi soldiers all around us, and we drove right through the middle of them as if God blinded them. And then we all gather into the American embassy. Within a few days, the embassy got locked down. They eventually turn off the water, the fresh water, and electricity to get us out. Heat was 120 degrees, no air conditioning. But the hardest part, I think, came 6 weeks later when Lori and Peter and Aaron left the embassy, and I turned them over to Iraqi soldiers to take to the airport. Those are hard moments, even this many, 30 years later. Because I want to live out God's call. And part of that living out that call is being connected to God's spirit. And what is God asking you to do? And is he big enough to take care of you? Or do you think you have to do it all yourself? That is the struggle of following God. And then turn to God. God, if my life is taken, are you going to take care of the boys? Are you going to take care of the wife? Can I trust you? What was going on in the background of the story that I didn't know was thousands and thousands and hundreds of thousands of people were praying for me personally.
My mom, my brother, and I now were back in Nashville living. And it was coming up for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering that the International Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention puts together, a week of prayer leading into this big offering every December. And there were literally millions of Christians all throughout the country that were praying specifically for my dad to be released.
And it really wasn't real to me until I got on the plane in Baghdad that I was actually going to leave and survive and be home. It's not about me. It's about the millions of people praying and God doing a miraculous event.
I believe that God is looking for people who are willing to move towards the hard places and stay even when it's hard and trust that the Holy Spirit still speaks and confirms his promises in our lives.
Amen. We have collected $1,771.50 towards the 2023 goal of $3,000 for our Lottie Moon Christmas offering. It's still not too late to contribute to this very important offering. Thank you so very much.
Amen. 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 Thank you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Y'all ready to sing some praise to God this morning?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, well, go ahead and stand up with me, and let's sing praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Today. Kind of seems like a shift from Christmas, but when we're going through those difficult times, what is it that lifts you out of it? Well, here's one option for you. Love lifted me.
Amen.
Oh,
All right, and now nearer to the heart of God. It was like God got a hold of me and went, I've got you. It's okay. I've got you. The beginning of the beginning of a new year can be challenging for a lot of us for a lot of different reasons. And I was definitely going through some challenges. Not anything bad, just, you know, challenges and things. During practice, like, the Holy Spirit just kind of, you know, tapped me on the shoulder and was like, it's going to be okay. So, sing with me today a song that was special to my heart this week, His Eyes on the Sparrow.
Should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? great song set. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And you know, as we watched our video this morning, and the folks were fleeing Kuwait, and when Missionary Daddy had to hand his wife and two young sons over to the soldiers. Thank you. Wow. That gripped my heart, folks. That gripped my heart. You say, well, he's a missionary. He's a missionary. God gives them special grace.
Amen.
Well, that's true in one sense, but it's no more special than the grace he gives you and me.
Amen.
To share Jesus right here at home. I hope and pray that you'll continue to pray, continue to give to this special, special offering for our foreign missionaries, as well as to our church. Father, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity to sing your praises. We thank you for opportunity to speak your praises. We thank you for the opportunity to pray your praises. We thank you for the opportunity now to give so that other people can know, Lord, whether it's across the street or around the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, guys.
We will be observing the Lord's Supper. I'll be reading to you while the brothers are passing out the elements. I'll be reading to you from 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, starting at verses 23.
Just one plate on each side.
For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. That the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. Amen. Does everyone have the bread? And thank you very much. All right. Father, in the precious name of the Lord Jesus, thank you so much for your body that was broken for us. Father, thank you that by the stripes of Jesus, we have spiritual healing. God, we thank you for sending your son. We glorify you now in Jesus' name. Take and eat. All right. And then now for the juice. Jesus. God, your word told us that without the shedding of blood, there could be no remissions of sin. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Your word told us in the Old Testament during the sacrificial system that there is life in the blood. So, Father, we thank you that because of the shed blood of Jesus, we now have eternal life.
Thank you.
Thank you for our spiritual new life that we have because of the shedding of the blood of your Son. Father, we glorify you for this now in Jesus' name. Take and drink.
Thanks, guys.
while they are gathering those, it is time for the reading of Scripture.
Amen.
Right. Amen. Stand with me, if you will. I'll be reading to you today from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. All together. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God in Corinth, together with all the saints throughout Achaia, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the Lord and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. Father, in the precious name of the Lord Jesus, we do pray now that you will bless us to receive the word that you will send through your messenger, that we may apply it to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank y'all. Lots of helpers, lots of needs this morning. Thank y'all. Mighty, mighty grateful. It is so good to see you today, and just delighted to be back in God's house and in a brand new year. Brand new year means a brand new sermon series. We'll try it over there and just see. Okay? We're moving today into the book of 2 Corinthians, all right? We're trying to do a New Testament book, Old Testament book, New Testament book, Old Testament, okay? And so we did 1 Corinthians back the beginning of last year and had a great time in that, so we're gonna follow it up with Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, excuse me. It's actually the third letter, right? Remember that we talked about how there was a second letter that got lost somewhere in history, throughout history, and so this is officially the third letter, but it's okay. It's 2 Corinthians in our Bible, right? Paul wrote 13 books in the New Testament. I mean, the guy is a writing factory. He's a writing machine. But none of the other books are like 2 Corinthians. Some of the other books may be more profound in the depth of theology found in those books. But none of the other books is more precious than 2 Corinthians. Because Paul, after writing the first letter, remember, and he wrote the book of 1 Corinthians because the church was drifting into sin, the members were drifting into sin, and the church as a whole said, well, we don't know what to do about it. So they just let it go. And so Paul wrote a very strong letter to them in 1 Corinthians, and particularly about the man who was living with his stepmother. Not just in his stepmother's house, but as husband and wife. And so Paul wrote and then he followed that up with the letter that we have lost. He followed that up with this letter in which was highly, highly, highly emotional. And we'll see that as we go through. But he just poured out his heart to the Corinthians. I want to read a quote from one of the commentaries that I used. There's no way I could say this and do it properly. It was written with a pen dipped in tears from Paul's anguish of heart. And that's a phrase he uses in here. It contains more of the human emotion than any of his other letters. And so Paul was crying as he wrote this book. But the great thing about 2 Corinthians is it teaches us how to live through sin and live above sin, right? And the book concludes by saying, God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. So what a precious book it is. After Paul wrote 2 Corinthians, when he wrote 1 Corinthians, he sent it back in Titus' care back to Corinth. Paul was in Ephesus at this time, having a massive revival, but along with the massive revival also came a massive revolt. While Paul was in Ephesus, you remember a guy named Demetrius, who was a silversmith, who made little silver idols to celebrate the goddess Diana. And so Paul's evangelism and the growth of the church there in Ephesus was costing this guy money. He wasn't selling as many silver idols as he had been. And so he got with some of his other shopkeeper friends, and they said, I know what we'll do. Let's run him out of town. And the easiest way to do that is have a riot. That way we can at least get him out of town. If we don't get him out of town, we could kill him. And so they had this riot. They started this riot. And the people were swarming around him, to where there were no city police back then. I mean, it was all Roman army, right? And so they called the soldiers in, and they tried to disperse the crowd, and they just shifted and changed positions, changed locations, and they drug Paul and some of the other disciples into their stadium. And they figured, well, this would be as good a place as any to kill him, right? Because that's one of the things they did in their stadium was kill Christians. But Paul was waiting to hear back from Titus. And when the riot started, they had to rush him. They snuck him out of town, is what they did. And so he and Titus missed their connection somehow or another. And Titus, it was really important to Paul because Titus was bringing back the report from Corinth on how the people had responded, how they had reacted, how they had revised their thinking because of the first letter. And Paul was just anxious. You know, he's, I gotta hear. And, you know, nobody had cell phones, so it was really tough. It was eye to eye or not at all. And so they finally caught up with each other in Troas, but because he couldn't find Titus, he was thinking the worst. Well, they almost killed me. Maybe they actually killed Titus. And so there was a lot of anxiety there. But when they finally caught up with each other in Philippi, Titus reassured Paul that first letter, 1 Corinthians, had served its purpose. That the church had repented, the culprit had repented, and folks had gotten their lives right with God, and God was doing a great work because the people had been repentant. But, he said, there's another danger that's come up. Another danger. And that was Judaizers had come from Jerusalem. Judaizers who were people who said they had trusted Christ, but they still wanted all of the Old Testament laws to be observed as well as trusting Jesus. And so they had infiltrated the Jerusalem church, and they had gotten letters of recommendation, you know, letters of commendation, recommendation, so that they could go and visit other churches and be welcomed. But they had come into the Corinthian church and were beginning to preach another gospel, which Paul had warned the Corinthians about, you remember? He said, if anyone comes in preaching another gospel from what I've taught you, don't pay attention to them. But Satan had blinded eyes, and they had begun to listen to these Judaizers. And they were preaching another gospel, and they were also denouncing Paul's apostleship. They said, he doesn't deserve to be an apostle. You know, I mean, look who he is. I mean, he's a nobody. Why should he be anybody in God's economy? And so, the book covers a lot of things. This book, like I said, is very, very different from the rest of Paul's writings. And it just almost defies analysis. It's the least systematic of all the 13 books that Paul wrote. It's the least systematic. 1 Corinthians, you recall, was very deliberate. It was very objective. It laid it out in 1, 2, 3, almost in a sermon, right? Step 1, step 2, step 3, point 1, point 2, point 3. And it's easy to read. 2 Corinthians is much tougher to read because it's very subjective. And again, I want to read to you a quote from one of the commentaries I used. It sounds like the impassioned self-defense of a wounded spirit trying to appeal to sinful and rebellious and ungrateful children. So I mean, that's a pretty serious charge right there. Pretty serious charge. And because it's the most emotional book that Paul wrote, it's also the least formal. Okay? Least formal. So, background, context. Now let's get into the scripture, okay? Amen. There are two key words in the book that we'll see over and over and over. The first one is comfort, and the second is ministry. Follow with me on verses 1 and 2 that we read there a moment ago. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God in Corinth, together with all of his holy people throughout Achaia. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul identified himself here claiming to be an apostle by the will of God, not by his own will, right? Apostle by the will of God. And God had chosen Paul just like he's chosen you and me, right? The scripture tells us that he chose us from before the foundations of the earth. Even before God formed the earth, God called you and me to serve him. God called us to be his children and serve him. So, same way he gave Paul a job, same way that he gave Paul a call, he gave each one of us. He called each one of us to repentance, to salvation, and he called us to a specific job, just like Paul. Look at verse 3. I love this. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion, and the God of all comfort. Boy, what a precious verse. What a phenomenal verse that is. Comfort combines encouragement with alleviation of grief, getting rid of the grief that has come because of the pain that we're in, right? And the comfort combines encouragement and alleviation of that pain, alleviation of that grief that we're going through. This gives us God's peace. And that's what compassion is, the God of all compassion. Compassion is a compound word, com, with, and pathos, feeling. With feeling. And so God wants us to understand that through Jesus, He faced every temptation that you and I face. Through Jesus, He felt every pain that you and I feel. All of the issues at the beginning of the year, all of the problems with the job, all of the problems with the family, all the discomfort of our whole lives, whether it's physical or mental or spiritual or emotional, God understands it all. Number one, He created us. Number two, He lived in this same body that you and I are living in. So He could understand. So that He would understand. Look at verse 4. The God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort that we ourselves receive from God. The troubles, if you're reading King James, it says the afflictions, and that word is literally pressure, bearing down on us, threatening to crush us, to crush the very life out of us. God has given us those pressures on purpose, with purpose, and we're going to see that in just a moment. But the word literally means under pressure. When we can feel the problems and the pressures that other people are going through, we can give them comfort that the God of all comfort has given us. We can give them encouragement that the God of all encouragement has given us. We can share with them the peace that the God of all peace has shared with us. But we only get those things when we need those things. When we're going through pressure. When we're going through problems. And that's God's purpose, and that's God's timetable in all of these things. I took Deb out to eat Friday night at one of our favorite catfish restaurants. And as we were headed for the entrance, another couple was coming out. We didn't know them, but they gave us a word. They gave us a word, and they said, "Make sure you sit on the east end of the restaurant. There's heat. There's no heat on the west end." So we thank you. Walked in. They greeted us and said, "I said a table for two, please, on the east end." And she said, "I'm sorry, there are no more tables on the east end. You'll have to sit on the west end." Okay, we can do that. That's not an issue. And so we went over there on the west end, and sure enough, it's colder than a wedge. And we sat down, re-zipped our jackets, and said, "Well, God must have a purpose." A few minutes, this little waitress girl came over to us, and she said, "Welcome, we're glad you're here. And so what would you like to drink tonight?" All right? So we got a water and a Coca-Cola, you know? And so we sat there, and I said, now, when you bring the drinks back, we'll have our food order ready. I said, oh, before you go, what is your name? And she said, my name is Jordan. Great, Jordan, thank you for helping us tonight and serving us. I needed your name because in just a few minutes, Miss Debbie and I are going to pray for our meal, and we want to pray for you as our server tonight. And she said, oh, that's great. I said, how could we pray for Jordan? And she stood there just a second and said, well, there's really nothing for me, but she said, would you pray for my student pastor? She was 16, 17-ish. She said, he's really going through it right now. And I said, that's all I need to know. I can pray for your student pastor. So she walked off to get her Coke and her water, and in a few minutes she came back, took our food order, went and turned that in, and the restaurant was crammed. She must have had 10 or 11 tables that she was serving, including several with 6-8 people. But before the food was ready, she came back and sat down, you know, with two of us at a table for four. Well, she sat down, reached over and grabbed our hands, said, could I pray with you now? Would you pray for me now? Surely will. And, you know, prayed for her, prayed for her student pastor, prayed for our food. And asked God to use her, not only at the restaurant that night, but use her to encourage her student pastor. When finished the prayer, she didn't turn loose. And I looked up and she had tears just almost running down her cheeks. And she said, you have moved me to tears. She said, you can't believe how I needed that tonight.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for setting us on the cold West End. It's amazing what God will do if we just let him. If we just cooperate. You know, we could have gone and sat down at that table and said, oh, good grief, it's cold in here. And everybody on that end was already cold. You know, so it wasn't like I would have been saying anything that was a major announcement. I could have griped at Jordan when she came up to the table and said, can't you do something about the heat? No, she couldn't. If she could have, I'm sure they would have. But I could either be a blessing or I could be a bum. And I chose this time to be a blessing. There have been plenty of times I've been a bum. But God had a purpose. God had a call for us, a job for us to do Friday night at the restaurant. And this time, for once, I listened. And so Jordan went, got back our food, and I brought our food back after a little while. But when we have been through a situation that caused us pain, that caused us problems, that caused us pressure, we've received God's grace. We've received God's encouragement. We've received God's comfort. And we can share those things with other people. Now, I don't know if I've ever gone through what her student pastor is going through. I didn't ask. Wasn't my job to ask. I didn't have to know. She knew, and God knew. All I needed was to pray for Jordan's student pastor.
Amen.
And God will use all of us, any of us, to encourage and strengthen and comfort other people if we'll let him. Look at verse 5. The the God who comforts us with comfort, that we can comfort others with the comfort that we receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. He tells us right there, we're going to suffer abundantly when we live godly in Christ Jesus, Matthew 5:10. Those who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But the same root word, suffering abundantly, abundantly, in the end of that verse, so our comfort abounds through Christ. Same root word, abound and abundantly. If our problems don't abound, we're not ready for God's abundant encouragement, God's abundant strength. There's no other way to get that strength. There's no other time that we'll receive that strength other than when we need it. So, Paul goes on to say in verses 6 and 7, follow along with me there. Pardon. I'm sorry. If we're distressed, Paul said, if I'm distressed, it's for your comfort and your salvation. If we're comforted, it's for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings that we suffer. Unless we go through suffering, we don't receive comfort. It's just like exercising any other muscle. Unless we exercise our persecution muscle, we don't exercise the comfort and strengthening muscles either. When Pastor Ronnie is lifting weights, he has to start out with lighter weights. Now, not nearly as light as I have to start out with. But you start off with light weights and you do a lot of reps. So that your muscles are exercised. And you can add another 1 pound, right? And, you know, and in Brother Ronnie's case, you know, he puts another 20 on each end, right? You know, it just, you know, just getting it. But he's just that kind of guy. But if we're going to start walking, you know, as a New Year's resolution, you don't start off walking 10 miles a day. No, you walk around the block to see if you can make it the first time. And then if you're going, you know, you're still breathing, you think, I think I can do another one, right? And so you get it, and you realize how much farther the second time around is than the first time. So you take it a little bit at a time, you exercise those muscles, you build them up. If your goal is this year to run a 5K before next Christmas, you don't start off running a 5K the first day. No, you run around the block, right? Or at least to the neighbor's driveway. And so we get that. And the only way that we get that comfort and that encouragement from God is when we are going through hard times. It's kind of like the old song, love and marriage go together like a horse and carriage. Love and marriage, you can't have one without the other. You can't have comfort and confidence and endurance unless you're exercising those problem muscles. All right? And he says then, verses 8 and 9, read with me here. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in Asia. We were under great pressure, so that it was far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired of life itself. We thought we were going to die. Paul thought he was going to die in Ephesus, and they snuck him out of town. Indeed, verse 9, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. Wow. Now that's a problem. Just like our missionary family in the video this morning. Are we going to live? Are they going to shoot us? I've got an assault rifle pressed against my chest, and it's cocked. That, my brothers and sisters, I think would probably qualify as pressure. That would probably qualify for God to send some pretty quick comfort. Right? But Paul said, we were there. We were there. You stop and think about the lists, the two places that he listed all the times that he had been beaten, that he had been shipwrecked, that he had been scourged, that he had been beaten with rods. But God delivered him. God delivered him. But why did God bring him to that point? Why did God bring him right up to the point of death and then deliver him? It was in verse 10, he has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we've set our hope, so that he will continue to deliver us as you help us by your prayers. We can help each other by our prayers. God puts us in tough places so that we look to God and not to ourselves. I had to carry Daddy to a doctor appointment last week at the hospital. And in that doctor's office was a sign that I had never seen. Well, I'd never been to that doctor's office, but I'd never seen that sign in anybody else's office either. But it said, you never know how strongly you can depend on God until depending on God is all you have. That's powerful. That's powerful. You never know how strongly you can depend on God until depending on God is all you have. And when we pray for each other, we help each other by our prayers. Verse 11 says, then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to the prayers of many. You know, we put a short prayer list in your worship guide, your bulletin, every Sunday. Not just so that you can look at it and say, God bless us, folks. And that's the end of it. I guess that qualifies as prayer, but if that's all you're going to pray for me, I'm going to go ask somebody else to pray. God bless the missionaries. Save the heathens. Right? No. God, pray God's blessings. Pray God's protection. Pray God's hand of encouragement. Pray God's hand of compassion would come alive in your heart. Pray for other people like you would want them to pray for you. Right?
Amen.
Pray for other people like you want them to pray for you. And when we do that, verse 11 said,
many will give thanks on our behalf because you answer prayers. You answer the prayers. Folks, God will get the glory when we suffer, right? God will get the glory when he comforts us. God will get the glory when we comfort others with the comfort that we've received. And then God will get the glory when we pray for other people. God comforts us so that we can comfort other people. God doesn't comfort us just so we'll be comfortable. God doesn't comfort us just so that we can check out the little block in our envelope, prayed, right? God's given us a job of praying for others, of comforting others, of being his representative in this world, his servant. I really pray that today has ministered to you. It ministered to me, and God got all over me just like he did Katrina. Make me a servant, God. That's our song of invitation today. That's where God wants us to be. Being a servant's not always comfortable. Comfort for other people is not always convenient. Compassion for other people is certainly not convenient. But it's where God wants us to live. Let's stand and sing together. Pastor Ronnie and I are here. If we could pray with you. Make me a servant, Lord. Our heart cry this morning. Make me a servant. Because God, if I'm not a servant, I won't recognize that this pressure is coming from my master. If I'm not a servant, I won't recognize that these problems are being allowed by my master. If I'm not a servant, I won't realize that these pains are being allowed by my master so that you can comfort me. And then I can in turn comfort other people. God, make us servants today. Make us servants this week. And use us to share Jesus with other people. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for coming this morning.